అయ్యర్ గారు నమస్తే.
నమస్కార్,
వెల్కమ్ బ్యాక్ వ్యూయర్స్ ఫర్ PGurus. I had a discussion with C. Iyer last time, specifically regarding the stock markets. We discussed about the high frequency trading last time. So I want to continue the same where we left off last week. Iyer sir, so okay, let me just give the customary request for the viewers to subscribe to PGurus, one of the best channels we have in YouTube. To get quality information on various subjects across the board, from international politics to finance to, you know, a lot of other things, especially to things related to nationalism, Indian nationalism. Okay, so let me take this forward, sir. Yes, sir, we last time discussed about, you know, the high frequency trading and its implications on the stock market, specifically on the Indian stock market. So, sir, let's go to the next one, sir. We had a budget. You know, there was obviously a lot of euphoria from the ruling side, and you know, everything seems to be negative if you look at from the opposition side. It's always been the case. So, but sir, it's always believed that stock market is a barometer of the economy of the country, and budget and the events that happen over a period of time. You know, it's that's at least the belief in those people who are in the stock markets. So ever since the budget was announced, we don't see any, you know, much euphoria in the stock markets. And in fact, you know, we have seen a little bit of correction. I think the markets have fell down from maybe 4 to 5% since the budget is announced. So do you see any particular reasons or anything fishy about this? What's your comments?
Well, when stock market takes a fall, that typically means looking forward, the stock market doesn't think that very good things are going to happen because of the budget. If you look at the budget, what was it that sent the stocks down? One of the things was that they were going to tax an additional 3%, I think, for people whose net worth was over 5 crores. And I think it goes up a little bit further if it is, I think, 10 crores or 8 crores. I don't remember. There were two slabs. And so essentially, the taxation rate was going up on high net worth individuals. And the other thing is that the budget didn't really excite anyone. Now, the long-term capital gains tax was in. That was not there before. It just got inserted in the interim budget. And now it kind of got confirmed. So people feel that perhaps government wants a slice of their earnings and in the stock market. Now, India stock market is not a true barometer of the country because the definition of organized sector, which is what constitutes companies which have like private limited or public limited with a board of directors, management, and all those things, the contribution of that to the GDP is probably 10 to 12%. That's it.
Okay.
So I think I told in the previous section, previous episode also, that of the 5,000 listed stocks in stock exchanges, only 150 at the most on a given day are active. And even those revolve around the Nifty 50. So that's 50 of a Nifty 50. And then another 100 stocks. These are the only things that are active. So when the stock market goes down in general, that means that all the stocks are going down, which means that there is a certain loss of confidence. However, that's not the only thing that would cause this gradual decline. Is that the other reason could be that foreign capital that was invested into India's stock markets could be fleeing the country for better returns. Now, that better returns is a very loosely defined word. We don't know what the foreign investor was looking for when he was investing in India. For instance, the FIIs can invest in the interest rate arbitrage between what they borrow in, say, United States, which today is around 3%, and take that money and bring it through a Mauritius company and put it in the Indian stock market and just get simple interest on that. That means, you know, like a fixed deposit, say, let's say 1 year. Okay, so the FIIs can use that route And I think the FIR, the fixed deposit is around 7%. I'm just giving a number. It could be off a little bit here or there. So 7 minus 3 is 4%. 4% is their return on investment. And for that investment, they're doing nothing. They're just keeping it in Indian bank through a Mauritius route to not pay capital gains tax. Now, if India's if the budget doesn't if the budget doesn't cut the rates, then they'll say that okay, 4% is India. Maybe Dubai gives 6%, and all else being the same, they may go towards Dubai. So, in order to attract foreign investment, sometimes India ends up artificially pegging the interest rate at a higher rate, even at the expense of hurting its own people. Because when the interest rates are set at a higher rate, the interbank lending rate goes up, which means the common man's interest also goes up. That's not a good state of affairs, but it depends upon what state the country's foreign exchange buffers are. If the country's foreign exchange buffers are healthy, then they can take the chance of lowering the interest rates, thereby giving loans at a lower interest to the people, and thereby, you know, enhancing growth. Now, right now, where India is in a bit of a pickle, not because of its own making, but because of geopolitical factors. What are the things? Like, US reneged on its deal with Iran. So, and all the the sanctions were imposed back on Iran. US has the financial muscle because it is the strongest player in the financial markets world over. They could essentially arm wrestle everybody to impose the sanctions on Iran and suddenly put pressure on Iran. Iran has counteracted in two ways. One is they have started enriching uranium again. And the second is they are beginning to man the Hormuz Strait, through which 25% of the crude travels for the world. You saw that, you know, they seized one UK registered vessel.
Yes.
They also shot down a US drone, and US in turn shot down their drone. And then one other drone went and damaged another vessel. So these kinds of things. You know, essentially, it's like letting off steam, like a pressure cooker. Iran is letting off steam because the pressure is building inside them, and they were able to supply crude to India in exchange for rupee and barter, and also for India to help them develop the Chabahar port. The Chabahar port, India was going to add two more terminals. They were going to repair the infrastructure, and I think they have done some repair of the infrastructure. And the other thing India was going to do was to use the Chabahar port and then develop a railway line, taking it from Chabahar all the way to the Afghan border, and then continue the railway line into Kabul.
Okay.
So the many steps that India had planned to work with Iran to have a path to connecting with Afghanistan. I mean, India imports Afghan products like almonds and some other nuts and stuff like that. And India also exports food to Afghanistan. So this was a good arrangement that India had planned. Now, all that stuff has come apart completely. Not only that, India used to get 40% of its crude requirements from Iran. Now, there are two things here that is hurting India. One is India's refineries are built to process the sweet crude of Iran better than perhaps the not-so-sweet crude of either Middle Eastern countries or Saudi Arabia or even Kuwait. So the crude itself, depending upon how much sulfur is embedded in it, is categorized. Sweet crude, less sweet crude, and there are some categories. Now, Iran's crude is the best crude in that respect. Sweetest crude, I believe. And because India's refineries also are not set up to take the other crude from Saudi Arabia, the refineries also cannot perform at highest capacity. Second problem is now India has to suddenly use its foreign exchange reserves to buy crude from Iran also. See, so the suddenly there is more demand to use up the same foreign exchange. So, and the foreign exchange reserves are not bad. They are around 425 billion. So India is not in a bad shape, but it depends upon how long this conflict is going to last, what form and shape it's going to take. Will India be able to get an exemption from the United States so that it can continue to do trade with Iran. Humanitarian grounds, for example, Iranians cannot be allowed to go die. United States doesn't want the population to suffer because of its policies. What it would rather do is it will just allow, they will punish the government, but they will always spare the people. Now, something like that could have been done with India's help, because India could have been that buffer which would have been able to manage all these things. Now, it is still possible. It is still possible that India and US might come to some sort of an agreement of that nature, wherein India gets the exclusivity to be able to still continue to draw down crude from Iran, and also continue to develop the Chabahar port, continue to work on some of its commitments so that it can start reaching Afghanistan, not just by road, but by rail also. That requires a fair amount of diplomatic handling, deftness in handling. I'm not saying that Jaishankar or Modi are not capable of doing this. I mean, Modi has done a tremendous job, because he got the Iran deal done. He also went and got a currency exchange deal, I think $75 billion with Japan. Which means that you can park $75 billion of rupees in Japan, and they would give you that much yen. Essentially, that's what it means.
Okay.
Okay, so India has that, you know, it can also draw on that $75 billion if it wants to. So he built up all these safeguards. But I don't think he bargained for Trump to renege on a government-to-government deal with Iran. Now, that is a problem. And if that gets solved, then maybe India's problems will soften up a little bit. But, you know, so that is one challenge. So the budget is not exactly a ringing endorsement of building wealth. Rather, the budget appears to be more about distributing wealth. Now, there is a problem with this concept, because you have to have wealth to distribute it. And you really don't have wealth, which is why they are going after these high net worth individuals, and they are trying to make them pay more. Now, there's an unfortunate consequence because of that. One is that close to 40,000 high net worth individuals have fled the country for greener pastures. For example, Canada has officially declared that they need about 1 million residents in the next year. Now, if you qualify for their immigration, you get a green card the day you land in Canada. The day you land. And in 2-3 years or 5 years, whatever, you become a citizen of Canada. Now, if you are a high net worth individual and you have your money salted away outside of India, it's child's play for you to get a Canadian citizenship. This is not the only country. There are many other countries that give citizenship if you give a certain amount of money into the country, bring some amount of money and create some jobs in the country. United States also is one. You can do that with the United States also. So when high net worth individuals leave the country, two things happen to the country. One is the bigger tax base gets eroded significantly. The second thing is the HNIs are the ones who are the job creating engines, because they made their money by creating successful businesses. And these made products, these products employed people, these things created need for services around this, and that employed more people. You see how this goes. So India is now, India is in a reverse spiral. It's spiraling reverse. Now, for some reason, I don't know why, India has this awful bad luck of making poor choices for the finance minister, whether it was Mr. Chidambaram or Jaitley or Piyush Goyal or Nirmala Sitharaman. None of them are really economists. Economists in the true sense, like macroeconomics. Macroeconomists are those who took at the entire country's economy. And whenever change you make, that change is almost always going to affect something else. So this equilibrium has to be always kept in mind while making these changes. Whereas I don't think that is happening now. So this distribution of wealth from the budget, higher taxes on high net worth individuals is what is causing this run on the stock market. But there is one other unknown reason, I mean undefinable reason, but that is felt itself, is how much of the participatory notes based investment is fleeing from the stock market. Let's take a look at this. Last year, what had happened was the SEBI, the Securities Exchange Board of India, wanted to add some more requirements on the purchasers of P-notes. They wanted the ID of the person who was the originating person in India. Now, there was such a hue and cry that the stock market fell about 8% or something like that last year. And in the Bombay Stock Exchange, there is a group, there is an association that represents all these people. They had said, if you don't stop this thing, already $60 billion have left the market. And they said that the BSE itself contains about $300 billion in FII. So they said $60 billion is gone. That means 20% is gone. The remaining 80% will also go if you insist on implementing this participatory note rule, which was supposed to have kicked in on October 1st, 2018. The SEBI promptly got cold feet and they stopped that. They kicked down the can for one more year and that's not going to happen. So essentially, the pervasiveness of the P-notes, the shadow that it casts on India's stock markets, it continues to be there. Although the amounts have started coming down, but I can't say it is zero, nor can I say how much is still left in India. According to that one association, 220 billion of P-notes was in BSE alone. And NSE is probably a bigger exchange. I don't even know how big a number there is there.
Yeah.
So, and these participatory notes are owned by individuals who are extremely rich, and they are also politicians in India. And they use all sorts of shell corporations, all sorts of masked ways to not let out the name of the real owner, which is why the P notes were there. P notes just has an amount. It doesn't have the name of the individual who owns it, which is really unfortunate. Mm. This was done by the P notes itself was introduced in the 90s, I think 99 or so, or 98, by Yashwant Sinha, then BJP finance minister. But BJP did not misuse it. It was a Congress UPA government that came in 2004 that made the participatory notes completely opaque by taking away the name of the owner. And once that happened, this became the vehicle to take black money out of India, launder it, make it white, bring it back into India via participatory notes, and then force the market to buy these stocks, pump up some stock, and then take the profits out. And till I think 2 years ago, there was no capital gains due on those also. So all these things are now beginning to come and hit them. That's probably why the stock market is going down. Now, how long this is going to last, when it's going to turn around, you know, it all depends upon a lot of factors. The other interesting thing about India is 50% of India's population is involved in agriculture, but only 18% of India's GDP is from agriculture. So it's become a very labor-intensive job. Now, if the rains fail, then that 50% starts screaming a lot. And then just to keep them quiet, the government typically goes and gives sops. Either they will, you know, waive the loans, or they will give them some sort of a sop. You can't blame them, because if there is no rain, what are they going to do? How can they harvest? They cannot harvest. So even rain is conspiring against India this year. So we have to see when at the end of the rainy season, like by October, whether it's going to be an average rainfall or a below or an above rainfall. So another thing is India's infrastructure, we have deforested so much that even if you have excess rainfall, that water cannot be stored. It washes off and goes into the ocean, which is really sad. I mean, we have essentially dumped garbage on our lakes, and therefore when water collects in these lakes, that water is not usable. You have to keep the lakes clean. Now, Art of Living has started a movement to do this thing. They're also bringing rivers to life. Yes. But it's not something that just one group of volunteers should do. A significant percentage of India's population needs to get involved in this. Let's hope that happens. But I think I explained to you what happened in stock market. If there's any other questions, please feel free to ask me.
Yes, sir. Regarding P notes, you know, I've been actually observing the stock markets for around 10 years now, and it's always been there. You know, one segment of the market asks for the abolition of the P notes, and the other section will obviously oppose it. The basic question here is, why should we keep the stocks rates of the stocks high just based on liquidity? But the rate should be determined by the fundamentals of the company, right? And even if the P notes goes out, it essentially means that the liquidity gets dried and you know the stock markets will fall, but eventually you know it will have to find their its own rate, right? So why should we bother about the temporary fall of the stock market at the especially at the expense of you know bringing back the corrupt money, you know, money we don't know the sources of? So is it not a bigger risk, sir, rather than you know, rather we should not, should we not allow the stock markets to fall if at all it's the case for a shorter period of time?
You see, the problem lies with the ability of the political leadership. You know, someone of the stature of Modi is able to win elections, but does Modi have the chutzpah means the ability to be able to figure out what is wrong with India's stock market, why it's important that P-notes be banned, and if P-notes are banned, what is the impact, and how can that impact be mitigated? That means be counterbalanced by something else. So a lot of these, that's why the macroeconomics is a state of equilibrium. You do one thing that will cause some instability. You have to do something else to tamp it down. And while doing all these things, you need to be able to bring prosperity to people, make people feel good, make people feel that they are wealthy. Now, one other problem that India has is how it allows convertibility of the rupee. It's a very opaque thing. People say that the rupee is weighted against a bunch of global currencies, and based on that it moves. But the reality is that it almost always moves in accordance with what happens with the India's foreign exchange and how it is importing stuff, whether it is foreign direct investment thing, like an Indian-based company wants to import $1 billion worth of machinery, that is an FDI, then they have to figure out how to get that money in, whether the Indian company is going to apply for that big number in dollars from the Reserve Bank and get the money, or if some partner is picked outside of India and they put the money into this company for equity partnership. Now, there are some success stories in India also where this kind of money has come in and really boosted stock. One thing that comes to my mind is MTR Foods. MTR Foods is a branch of or offshoot of a very quirky, small, but very popular hotel in Bengaluru called MTR, Mavali Tiffin Room. That was the full name. There were only two shops, one in Lal Bagh Road and one in Malleswaram or something like that. And this has been around for 70, 80 years. In fact, even before that. And they used to, in the initial days, they used to serve all their food in silver utensils.
Oh.
And everything was in ghee. And it used to be extremely tasty. And people used to stand in line before the restaurant opened in order to get in. That's how popular it was. So a couple of Swedish investors came in, and Swedish or European investors, I don't know. I'm not 100% sure about the nationality. European investors came in and invested in MTR Foods. And today you see that MTR Foods is in, you know, you go to any food place, you'll see that all sorts of, you know, goods that you can get from them. Now,
Masalas,
not just masalas, even things like
masalas,
pindi masala,
chili powder, a lot of things. Yeah.
No. You can get even finished food like Puliyodhara also they can get.
Oh, yeah. That's true, sir.
Right. So MTR was the first choice for even the British. See, what happened was, I think it was the Second World War maybe, there was a rice shortage across the country. And the British asked MTR to find a solution for this. And they came up with this thing called rava. You know, the rava dosa, rava idli. That rava concept, they only came up with that. And MTR also supplies to the army now. So your armed forces in Kargil and all border areas where they cannot really cook their own food, they just boil water, use these sachet packets and put it in, heat it, and then consume it straight from that. So they have a good market. And MTR exports a lot of stuff. I mean, in Indian stores, you find a lot of the stuff. So these are success stories where some foreign investor has found a good niche which could grow bigger if they had sufficient equity. And that's what happened in the case of MTR. I think Haldiram also is... either being bought by Pepsi or some big deal is going to happen for Haldiram also. Haldiram also did extremely well. So these kinds of things, we need more of those stuff. I mean, Flipkart deal, interesting thing is nobody in India really made money except for the two founders perhaps, because a lot of the investment into Flipkart came from Singapore-based investment company. And when the return, Walmart paid those Singapore investors, the money didn't even come to India. So, okay. You know, it's all great feeling that, oh, Walmart bought Flipkart, but it didn't really make a difference in the life of not just a common man, even the rank and file in Flipkart. I don't think they made a lot of money. There weren't many incentive stock options for them and so on and so forth. So India has a fair amount of catching up to do. The stock market needs to really be the place where you can make accurate price discovery. And you can make that only if you take away things like the P-notes. It has to completely go. Otherwise, the stock market will almost always inflate the price of any stock, and therefore no stock is worth buying. It is inflated. Anytime these guys can take the P-notes out, which means that the stock will crash.
Okay. So can we end with one more question, sir?
Sure.
Okay. So is having multiple stock exchanges an option to resolve this issue, sir? Because, you know, I know that, you know, everything was started with BSE, and after, once the NSE came, you know, I don't know what happened, you know, now it's like 90-10, I think it's not even 90-10, maybe 95-5, you know, it's almost, most of the trading happens only in NSE. BSE is almost, you know, like died down. I don't know why, any particular reason, sir, why there is no, you know, encouragement for multiple exchanges. I guess it was the case earlier. You know, we had Madras Stock Exchange, Hyderabad Stock Exchange.
Yeah. But
we used to have a lot of exchanges, right?
So I think I explained this in the previous episode. What happened was all these stock exchanges like Hyderabad, Madras, Bangalore, and all those things, they were trading in the well. That means the human being was doing the trades. That was not considered efficient.
No. This part you explained. So my question is, is there any conspiracy behind this, or it was you know, they just couldn't you know, catch up with the evolving technology? And, you know, I mean, I don't think that should happen, because, you know, when the other exchanges are doing 18 hours, obvious that you also follow them. Maybe you can be a little late, but you cannot simply die.
Well, what has happened is there was another series of stock exchanges that was promoted by Jignesh Shah, like the MCXSX, which would have gone head on against the National Stock Exchange, commodities exchanges, energy exchange, and so on. That there was a conspiracy theory by the P. Chidambaram rule. There's a book that I've written called C Company that talks about this. So they decided to keep out Jignesh Shah from the stock exchanges. They also decided to put all their eggs in BSE basket. I mean, not BSE, NSE's basket. And they allowed BSE also to die. So when NSE came up and government started openly supporting NSE, see, brokers are brokers. Brokers need to live to just sell and trade. They will sell your stock, they'll buy your stock, and they'll make a commission in that. So the same set of brokers who were in BSE also became brokers in NSE. And when they saw that NSE was giving them better benefit, because it was faster perhaps, the service was better. So
it was faster, sir. Another thing is, you know, they started the futures and options lot, you know, much before the BSE started, because when I was there, it almost took some 7-8 years for BSE to start futures and options. And you know that out of 13-14 lakhs crores trading that happens right now in the stock market, almost 80% happens in futures and options only.
Yes, so, and that's a really bad place to use your money, because you're fighting against high frequency trading computers. You're also fighting against a rigged market. And God only knows what. So I would not be a day trader. You will only lose money in the long run. So until every one of those trade traders lose money, like a lot of money, they will not realize that they are basically like playing in a casino. When you go to a casino, you only lose money, unless you play blackjack extremely well, and then maybe you can come out with a little bit of profit. That's it.
Okay. Sir, once I heard that, you know, stock market is a mechanism to transfer the wealth from the middle class to the rich. So
that is happening. That is happening. So people with disposable income should use it for other purposes, not to play the stock market.
So one last question, sir. Maybe it has become a little lengthy already. So what are your because, sir, if you go to the bank deposits, it's hardly 8-9%. You know, while your inflation is around 6-7%, so you hardly make any money. So stock markets are risky. Maybe mutual funds also the same thing. You know, they also invest in the stock markets. So maybe LIC also the same thing. You know, so where to invest? Middle class person.
Good question. Even real estate today is not very safe.
Yeah.
What I would do is look at some of the mutual fund portfolios. If you have good companies in that portfolio, you can invest in those, and they will give you 11 to 12%. I think fixed deposits also give you good numbers. And but you have to keep it for 1 year. If you break it in between, you have to pay a penalty. So those things will give you a little bit better. I would not put money in stock exchange, at least not now. You have to wait for the stock exchange to find its bottom, and then perhaps you can put money.
So are we on a downward, you know, are we going down, sir? Are you, you know, is we are in the early part of the correction?
Yes, we are in the early part of the correction. You saw today that news about India Bulls, that there's a 1 lakh crore loss, and India Bulls is a fairly well-known name. Their stocks are all down 8 to 10% today. And India Bulls.
What happened, sir? India Bulls, I know, because I was an employee of India Bulls at some time.
Oh, you should read PGurus article today. There's a they did some financial skullduggery. The news appeared yesterday. It was exclusive. It only appeared in two places, PGurus and Daily Pioneer, in Pioneer newspaper today morning. And they did some mischief. And Dr. Swamy has written to the Prime Minister, and as a response to that, India Bulls sent a letter of explanation to NSE last night, saying that what's in that letter is not true, but the market is not willing to believe them. It's all their stocks across the board, all India Bulls variations, you know, they're all down in 8%. So we'll wait and see. So there is a correction. There is also Island FS that is sticking still. So you take anything, you're only seeing problems, because these are all NPAs. These are all induced problems that happen because of creative ways to corrupt, which is what the Chidambaram government did. So, not Chidambaram, but the Manmohan Singh government did. Chidambaram was the main guy, because he was always around finance. So, but, you know, the courts have to act quickly, and let's hope that, you know, justice gets done fast, because stock market is a key indicator of the country's economy. And it can be a good place for funding for new startups also.
Okay, Yerji. Thank you very much for the detailed explanation about a lot of things that most people doesn't even know or heard of anywhere else. Thank you so much. And you know, maybe you know, as the time goes by, we'll have better clarity on what is happening with the India Bulls as well.
Yes.
And as you say, you know, people wait for some more time. As far as IRG is concerned, we are in the early stages of correction. So it's always been my experience also to buy when the stocks are falling, not when they are, you know, making headlines. You know, like BSE went up by 1,000 points and all these things. Whenever you see these headlines, it's better you be away from the stock markets and only, you know, invest when the stock markets are, you know, done with their correction. Thank you, Ajit. Namaste.
Thank you.
Hope to speak with you soon again. Yeah. Namaste.